Theodore H. Frank for the appellants. This case raises a couple of questions that Lane versus Facebook left open, but we think are thoroughly addressed by precedents in other circuits, such as Bank America and Judge Easterbrook's and Judge Posner's opinions in Terza and Pearson, and in this circuit by Notch and Dennis, and the principle in Radcliffe that class counsel owes an undivided duty of loyalty to the class. With respect to the two major issues here, the first is, under what circumstances can there be an all-Cypre settlement? What does it mean for there to be an economically viable distribution possible? And the other is the scope of what sort of conflicts of interest or appearance of conflicts of interest is permissible. The courts and parties ask for a definition of distributable that requires that every single class member get something, and therefore, because there are 130 million class members, $8 million is not distributable. I would agree that if this had to be distributed to 130 million class members, $8 million would not be distributable. But that's not the legal standard, and the standard that they're asking for would effectively turn every consumer class action in this circuit into an all-Cypre settlement. It's very rare that a settlement of a consumer class action settles for more than a dollar per class member, and parties invariably rely upon a claims process to sort of throttle the amount of money that's going out to under 10% of the class, or more frequently under 1% of the class.
You had opened your argument with the citation to a number of cases. Do you have any case where it was determined by a circuit court that the district court abused its discretion in imposing a Cypre settlement upon a finding that the settlement was non-distributable?
Yes, Pearson, 772 F3rd 778, took express issue with a residual Cypre distribution.
Was that a case where there was a question about the Cypre recipient?
I don't believe the Cypre recipient was challenged in that case. There, the residual is $1.1 million. There is 13 million class members. The court held that Cypre has to be a last resort, and the party should have done more to actually get money to the class. And on remand, that's exactly what happened. Bank America is another case that involves the distribution of a residual. The money of $2.7 million was distributable to 100,000 claiming class members, even if it may not have been distributable to the entire class of Bank America shareholders.
Yeah, Pearson Council seems quite distinguishable to me. I mean, this is a much, much smaller class. Rexall had the addresses of its prior prescription holders and knew how to find them. And if they wanted to give them, send them a $3 coupon, it could have sent them a $3 coupon. That just doesn't seem close to what we've got here.
Well, it's still, even if you just look at the identifiable class members, it was 3.7 or 4.7 million class members. And 1.1 million divided by 4.7 million class members, you're still, $3 coupons would only get you less than 6, 7, 8, 9% of the class there. And again, is it economically viable to distribute money to 130 million class members if you have a claims process or even a lottery process? And admittedly, no court has actually done that yet. But the fact of the matter is, Fraley versus Facebook was 130 million class members, and they figured out a way to get millions of dollars to the class. And in fact, the number of claims was so small that they increased the distribution from $10 to $15 and still had money left over. Now, that was a $20 million fund versus an $8 million fund. But that still raises the possibility of distributing $6 or $7 million here. And again,
so what do you think the district court should have done here?
The district court should have rejected the settlement as inappropriate under 3.07. It does not meet the standards of 3.07 because it was economically viable to do some sort of distribution to the class.
And how should we have done that?
I'm sorry?
How how should we have distributed some money? I mean, the money is to be determined, so the amount, but how should you have contacted another
community? You created a $1 million common fund. You have a claims process, and you can...
Okay, tell me what that claims process
is. How much is that going to cost?
Well, it costs $1 million to do the settlement administration in this case without any distribution. It's hard to see how, why it would need to cost money.
I'll be really specific with my question. I've tried to give it about three times. I'll do it again.
I apologize if I missed it.
How do you contact 130 million people?
The same way they contacted them to notify them of the settlement. You send them an email. The class got notice here. They got individualized notice.
Questions so far have been going to one point, but there's another area in here that I'd like to have your view on, and that's how the money was sent, that is, who the recipients would be under Cypress. It's clear there was a connection between the plaintiff's lawyers and the individual recipients. When there's something as clear as that, usually there's a record made to make sure that the proper people have been or proper institutes. I don't see any place where there's been a record made. The judge had a conversation, but I didn't see any declarations. I didn't see any testimony. Was there any?
There was not. They made a purely legal argument, and on appeal they've introduced hundreds of pages of new record evidence regarding the grant proposal, but we would argue that a grant proposal does not protect against this sort of conflict of interest. It's exactly the sort of conflict of interest. It's precisely the conflict of interest criticizing the class council giving money to the alma mater. And I think by the negative pregnant of what they argued below and by the recent 28J where they identified the Google cookie settlement where no money went to Chicago Kent because there weren't any attorneys who had gone to Chicago Kent in that settlement, it sort of shows what was going on here.
It's the type of thing, it seems to me, when it's raised, needs to be taken care of at the district court level. When it gets to us, it just looks odd. What do they call it? The smell test or something. You wonder how the district judge made the determination that there was no influence by any of the plaintiff's lawyers into the determination of the recipients. And without any record, I just don't know how you make that decision.
Well, there are two problems with the district court's reasoning. One, they improperly put the burden on the objectors to prove what was going on in the heads of class counsel, even though the burden rests with the moving party, as cases like Pampers and other cases we cited hold. And two, the court reasoned, well, some of the people in this settlement had connections to Harvard, but not all of them did, because it was a negotiated settlement. The presence of non-Harvard people and non-Chicago Kent people in the settlement negotiations immunized the selection. And I think that's clearly erroneous for the reasons we stated in our brief.
We're on an abuse of discretion standard, is that right?
We are under an abuse of discretion standard, but applying the wrong standard of law is an abuse of discretion, and we make that argument. And I think the district court did abuse its discretion, given the negative pregnant of the relationship of the parties and the failure to apply the right standard.
Tell you one of my problems with the claim that there is this relationship. I mean, it's not random that these particular universities were chosen because they have the kind of centers that are relevant here. And, of course, given the number of lawyers that have gone to some of these schools like Stanford and Harvard, et cetera, I think that simply saying because somebody was your alma mater, I don't see how that's enough of a connection to be viewed as a conflict.
Well,
do you have something more that we should be looking at?
Well, we have the 3.07 standard. We have the precedent of NOSH, which specifically singles out that particular kind of conflict of interest. And even the district court below said that Cypre shouldn't be used for alumni fundraising. And why it didn't follow up on that in its actual opinion, I don't know, but at the hearing, it was very critical about these recipients didn't satisfy the smell test and that there was a lack of transparency in the selection process. And again, in terms of raising substantial questions were raised about these recipients in a 2012 Fortune article because it's the usual suspects that Google gives money to. These are organizations that Google already gives money to and works with and that generally support Google on most of Google's issues. And this was raised in an article in 2012, long before this case, and if 3.07 is the correct standard, I think that creates the substantial questions necessary to find the recipients problematic. And Dennis identifies that too, where the defendant regularly gives money to a particular charity, the fact that the settlement requires that sort of donation, that's just a shift in accounting entries. That's what Dennis versus Kellogg called a paper tiger.
But has there been a court that's adopted 3.07, a circuit court of appeals?
Yes, Pearson did. Terza cited it favorably. Bank America said...
They said it's favorably, sorry to use, but is there anything more than that, that this is going to be the standard?
Bank America, 775 F3rd, specifically said we're adopting 307.
Is that the Seventh Circuit?
That's the Eighth Circuit. I'm well into my rebuttal time. I look forward to further questions.
May it please the court. Good morning, Your Honors. Catherine Nasseri for Plaintiff Pelley. I'd like to pick up where the conversation just left off. Oh, by the way, I'll be taking about 7.5 to 10 minutes, and then Mr. Falk will stand up. Judge Wallace, you asked whether there was a record that pertained to the alma mater question, and I'd like to direct you to excerpt on pages 6 and 49. Both myself and Michael Ashenbrenner submit declarations saying that, yes, these law schools were our alma maters, but that we had no current affiliations with the law schools or the centers within them.
Yeah, I understand that. But was this a written declaration?
Yes,
or a stated declaration?
It was both, Your Honor. We submitted written declarations on final approval, and at the fairness hearing, Your Honor, I believe I also stated orally that they are written declarations under penalty of perjury.
Okay, so
which have not been challenged, Your Honor.
Well, it's been challenged since that you say there's no current. You make the statement there's no current connection. It specifically does not cover past contacts. And I'm just wondering why there was not more done by the court. This is very important. Millions of dollars at stake. And they just seem to go to alumni of counsel. I'm not saying that's wrong. I'm just saying there should have been more of a record by the district court.
So, Your Honor, if I may, the record before the district court, first, as Judge McEwen recognized, even the district court called these recipients the usual suspects. This is a relatively narrow field, populated largely with law schools and centers within law schools that can do the kind of work in the privacy field that have a track record that's required under this court's precedent. So there aren't that many to choose from to begin with. In addition to that, Your Honor, I don't find a conflict between ALI 3.07 and this court's standards. In Nakshin, the standard is set forth, and it's very consistent with the comment in 3.07, which says there should be a selection of the SIPRI recipients should be on the merits. That's what 3.07 says. Nakshin says it should be tied to the statute and should benefit the absent class members. Well, here, Your Honor, we had over 100 pages of specific detailed proposals which were crafted specifically in response to this lawsuit and to benefit the class members. What I believe is unprecedented in this kind of, in SIPRI settlements, is the court had over 100 pages of proposals before it. And
of proposals by whom?
By the six recipients that made the finalists.
Not proposals by all of the people who might be involved, but by the six that had already been designated as the proposed recipients.
Subject to the district court's approval, Your Honor, and if any of them had not passed muster, they would have dropped out and there would have been five remaining or four remaining, as the case may be.
So, but the class that the district court is going to look at was already down to the ones who were alumni of the attorneys involved. There wasn't any opportunity for others to become involved and considered in a hearing by the district court.
Correct, Your Honor. Three of the six were alumni. The other three were not. And this was, there was a lively discussion, Your Honor, at both preliminary approval and final approval. The district court did lament the fact that there wasn't an opportunity to bring in new players.
Yes, and he was the one that talked about the smelling test. I didn't bring that up myself. And when a district court finds that, the question really is, was there enough done to protect the people who are not going to get the money, the class people, that this is an appropriate use of their money, and was there factual findings made to that extent? So the real question is, it's an abuse of discretion issue, but the question is, how much should be done? This is a new ball game over the last couple of decades, and we need to make sure that all of the interests are protected. And that's why I'm raising the question. I'm not criticizing anybody.
Your Honor, a couple of observations. First, the fact that the district court raised the question. I wish the court would have used different language, but raising the question alone. It's indicative that this was not a rubber-stamped process. The court spent a lot of time looking at this and put us on the hot seat. The other thing is, I don't know what more could be done, Your Honor, or that any more has ever been done in a case like this to determine that the selection of recipients was on the merits. Again, 100 pages plus. I've never seen anything like that before. And there was, Objector Frank is essentially asking this court to find that an alma mater, no matter how qualified, should be disqualified from the get-go. And that doesn't comport with any case law, including Nakshin. Your Honor, there is a statement in Nakshin about alma maters. But let's put it in context. What Nakshin says is, when you don't follow our guidance of ensuring that your recipients are going to spend the money in a way that promotes the objectives of the statute and benefits the class members, if you do not do that, then there is a risk that you're opening up the selection process to the whims of counsel of the court. This is not our case, Your Honor.
Mr. Frank also brought up the point of why you didn't try to get more money to the class as distinguished from going with a side praise. And of course, that is your responsibility. I'd like to hear your response to that. Why was there not some way to get additional funds out to the class as distinguished from Boyle's High Praise?
Yes, Your Honor. First, I'll note that Objector Frank does not contest the $8.5 million amount and say it should have been more. What he does say is that we should have made direct distributions. I'd like to correct the record before the court today. There was not individual email notice in this case. And to Judge Bybee's question, how do you get notice out to 130 million people? Well, the only way to do that when you cannot identify them and you don't have a database is by publication.
Which these folks are subscribers of Google's.
Some of them may be, Your Honor, but not all of them.
Some of them are simply users.
Correct.
So presumably Google could just simply post something, so when you went to Google, it would say, attention, if you think you used our services between these dates and these dates, do what?
Yeah.
Press a button and we'll send you 45 cents. I don't know what the, if the 8.5 isn't, I mean, we could make this really, really easy, but at that point, then, you're distributing 8.5 million over 130 million people.
Right, which if there were no distribution costs, Your Honor, that's something like 4 cents a person. And the other thing is that Objector Frame says, well, the district court erred as a matter of law by not distributing the money. Fraley is the proof, but there are some critical differences. First, the fund was much bigger. Objector Fraley noted it was $20 million, and after attorney's fees and distribution costs, it was still more than $10 million. The size of the class was smaller. Importantly, in that case, Facebook was the defendant, and Facebook had a database that both identified the class and had contact information for the class. And in that case, notice went out by email. That's quite different than our case, where, as we've just discussed, it's hard to identify the class, and notice would have to go out by publication.
Do we know how many of the class members would be Google subscribers compared to the overall class?
We do not, Your Honor. Unless the court has any further questions for me, I'll yield.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning, Your Honor. Donald Falk for Google. You know, there's a lot that's not at issue here. That ranges from the amount, which Mr. Frank said might overpay by a factor of four. The grave risks, most important here, I think, are the grave risks about standing, liability, class certification, and damages, the very circumstances that make this the type of case where Cypre relief is particularly appropriate. It is not a case where you have a record of individualized injury, in fact, and class-wide provable injury. You have a situation where that was one of the most hotly contested issues in the case, was whether anyone had been hurt by this at all. Now, there were grave risks. If plaintiffs, you know, ran the table on all these issues, you're looking at a lot of money. But it's a risk that a defendant and a plaintiff have to be able to compromise in some sensible way. And in this case, this is not, you know, the run-of-the-mill case, but in this case, where you have exactly those risks to be compromised, it makes particular sense, and there is less of an issue with individuals who are actually provably hurt being somehow shorted. Now, I think one of the ways you can know this is the remarkably low opt-out rate here of I think, 13 as opposed to several thousand in Fraley and Lee. It doesn't prove everything, but it does indicate that there aren't a lot of people out there who thought they were hurt and weren't going to be compensated. And that, I think, is a big difference. I mean, Lane, people's personal purchases were put up for all to see. You knew you had at least some people there that were really hurt. You don't have that here. It's also, I don't think, reasonably disputable that the distributees here, the recipients, were targeted in a way that would respond, ensure that their funding responded to exactly the harms that were alleged here. We don't think they can be proven. Plaintiffs think they can be proven, but we're clear on what was alleged here. It had to do with privacy, and it also had to do with internet privacy in a way that was responsive to education. And I'll explain why. The whole theory of this case is that people were entering things in their search field that, if you follow a long enough causal chain, would reveal things about them that maybe they didn't want to be revealed to the people that, you know, on whose sites they clicked. And if you learn that, you know, that's a risk, then maybe you don't, you know, put your name, your social security number, and a bunch of other data in a search field, at least without taking additional precautions to make sure that data isn't transmitted. And those precautions and the information about them are part of the injunctive relief here. Now, Mr. Frank would replace programs that really come at this issue, this privacy issue, this specific issue here from several directions, from education, from policy research, looking what kind of legislation will work, and even technical research. Carnegie Mellon's proposal, which is in the supplemental excerpts, and those, although Mr. Frank derides those, the court read them. He said so at page 44 of the excerpts, and they are what really limit what can be done and ensure that what is being done here is particularly responsive to what the class is interested in and what the statutes are supposed to protect.
But the question is, who can speak for the class? Now, the attorneys, the plaintiff's attorneys at this point, have already gotten their fee. They're not going to make any more money by this process. Google has made an determination how much willing to pay, so they don't have a particular responsibility of the class. There are ways of doing it, appointing a separate attorney for the class and let that attorney objectively take a look at it. There's a lot of money in the pot. So what I'm suggesting is a question that we have to answer. Was enough done here to be sure that the class whose money we're using got to the right place and was not interfered with by the people who are paying or the people who are receiving? I'm not sure that merely because attorneys no longer have a relationship with a unit or, on the other hand, that these claim to be Google recipients that are favorable to Google. I'm not sure without some type of independent hearing that we're really protecting the people whose money it is. And that's what I'm struggling with. Now, maybe there's no way you can do it, but this is not going to stop. This is a train that's on the tracks. We're going to see more of these cases, so it's a good time for us to look at it.
I agree with
that. I'm not being critical of anyone, you understand. I'm trying to look at fairness in the process.
Well, it's your job to be critical sometimes, Your Honor, so I don't mind you doing that. But I think the record here, the applications here, are in much greater detail than, you know, certainly Lane, where you had a one-sentence mission statement, and that was it. That was it. We didn't know where the money was going. We just knew there was a one-sentence mission statement that might connect to the donations to the recipients to the class.
But my problem here is that it's the attorney for the plaintiffs and the attorneys for the defendants that are bringing the proposal in. And there's no one at that point speaking for the people whose money it is going to be spent. So there's a hitch in the usual fairness that we have, that the people whose millions of dollars are involved are not represented. I don't know a way around that, is there?
Well, I think that the plaintiffs, I don't think there's any showing that the plaintiffs' attorneys in negotiating the settlement were unmindful of their duties to the class. And if I could just make two very quick points, and then I'll sit down about the notion that these were regular Google recipients. Stanford certainly has been a recipient, but not for privacy. And that's what Sanford said, and that was discussed in the excerpts of the record in 1991 and the supplemental excerpts of the application at 333-31. In fact, Stanford's research was used by the FTC to bring a case against Google. And who brought that case? Who was the complainant? The World Privacy Forum was the complainant in that case, as they say at page 367 of the supplemental excerpts. The others at pages 257, 283, 293, and 313, the largest donation to any of the other four recipients was about $300,000. Now you're looking at $1 million tailored to privacy. That's not an accounting
error. I think the objection here shouldn't be, and if it is, it would be misplaced, that the directed funds didn't have a direct relationship to the subject. That seems fairly clear. It wasn't just a donation to Stanford, some kind of fund. It was to a specific center at Stanford or to the Berkman Center, et cetera. The question is, as 3.07 says, is there any significant prior affiliation that somehow, even with that direct connection, would undo it because there's an appearance of impropriety or an appearance of conflict? So that seems to me to be the question that we have to answer. And do you have anything further that suggests that simply by being someone's alma mater that that's not significant? Or do we have any guidance on that?
Well, the question is whether it raises a significant, substantial question as to whether the selection was made on the merits. And I think the application process, the reputation of all these places, but particularly the application process and the commitment to use these funds in a particular way that's not going to help Google, in a sense it's going to insulate Google, it may improve Google's practices, and that's fine.
What if one of the attorneys was on the board of one of these universities? Would that be enough to be a disqualifying factor?
These are all factors, but I think to the extent that an abstract question, I mean, the fact that Mr. Frank says has a question doesn't mean it's a substantial question going to whether the selection was made.
My question was not Mr. Frank's objection. My question was, in your view, if one of the attorneys served on the board of one of these institutions, would that be disqualifying in and of itself?
I don't know that it would be automatically disqualifying. We don't have anything resembling that here. We don't have that kind of tight relationship or even the loose relationship that was found to be, you know, not sufficient to bar a donation when there's a large board for a public interest organization. I think if it was an organization that maybe had a board of five people and plaintiffs counsel was one of the five people for the particular directed recipient, that would raise substantial questions. It would take a lot to rebut that. We have a lot less here, and we've rebutted it here, Your Honor.
Thank you.
Thanks.
You have some rebuttal time.
To open with, this Court has repeatedly rejected an ascertainability requirement for class certification. It's perfectly okay for class members to identify themselves with declarations or statements under penalty of perjury. There's no requirement that every single class member be known to make a distribution to certify a class. The Third Circuit makes that requirement. This Court rejects it repeatedly in a variety of 23F cases. So the idea that, well, we don't know who the 130 million people are, doesn't excuse the possibility of a distribution. And they acknowledge under Fraley that they're able to distribute $15 per claiming class member with a $15 million fund. So you have a $6 million fund here, distribute $6 per claiming class member or something that would be pro rata after $1 million or so of. And if you have an online claim process, it would be clearly less than $1 million. To do that. I apologize on confusing Google cookies where I did get individual SMS with this oriented fund. But the fact that there was publication notice and the Court found that satisfied the process, there's no reason that same sort of publication notice would not satisfy the claims process. I very much am interested in answering questions you might have. I want to throw in one other point then, that Google makes the argument in its brief that they would have preferred giving the money to the charities rather than giving the money to the class, and that's the whole nature of compromise. But I think that just goes to show that this is not worth $6 million of Cypre is not $6 million of benefit to the class. Especially since a class member or any individual benefits, whether or not they're a class member, whether or not they've opted out. In fact, the rational thing for a class counsel looking out for the interests of the class members would be to instruct every single class member to opt out, because then they keep their claim, whatever it's worth. Google says it's feeble, and it's certainly settled for a feeble number. Though these are instead three times their lodestar for a feeble case. I forgot where I was going with that. But in any event, I'm happy to answer any other questions you might have.
I think that we've exhausted our questions for all counsel. So thank you very much. And the case of Gauss versus Google is submitted. Thank all counsel for coming and for your arguments today.
Good arguments.
One last case on the calendar, Padilla Ramirez versus Bible.